Ashok Rao. You know, he has been one of our prominent public intellectuals, and his theme is linked between public sector undertakings and public sector banks. Ashok.
Comrades, before I touch the subject of relationship between PSUs and public sector banks, let me start with the basic fundamental question: why the public sector at all? Let me start with acceptable nationalist Subhash Chandra Bose. Subhash Chandra Bose in 1935 raised this question when he was president of the Indian National Congress, and a planning commission was set up under Jawaharlal Nehru on looking into what should be the strategy after independence. Anyway, over the years we built a huge PSU sector, but what was really that we tried to achieve through the public sector? That is important to understand before we can make any linkages. The first was that there was a need for public sector when there was an unequal distribution of wealth and resources. Now, let me give you for each of these an example. I think I don't need to elaborate on that because everybody knows the unequal nature of distribution. FCI, for example. And this morning somebody mentioned about FCI. It is not possible for this country to have even survived, physically survived, but for FCI. We will need to elaborate more. The second was the whole issue of self-reliance. There was a big dispute on whether at all BHEL should be built, whether at all we should go for steel. You know, the Americans refused to support any steel in public sector. But the whole question was that what is the size of India? What kind of a size does India have? India is the size of a subcontinent. How can you build a subcontinent without the basic industries? If you take BHEL for example, BHEL is one of about 12 or 13 companies in the whole world. There is no BHEL in entire Latin America except for a very mini BHEL in Brazil. There is no BHEL in entire Africa. There is no BHEL in the entire Middle East. There is BHEL only in America, half BHEL in Canada, UK, France, Germany, Japan, South Korea, China. I think I can count the number of countries on our fingertips. So the question was that is it for a country of this size, population, is there a necessity to build basic industry or not? And that was addressed through this question of self-reliance. Then comes the question of control over natural resources. Is it important to have control over natural resources? The answer was yes. And what has happened? Zinc and copper, Hindustan Zinc, Hindustan Copper, these were started as private sector companies. But they were nationalized because both zinc and copper are very strategic minerals. And the kind of copper that we are mining, this kind of a copper will be used for road construction in Zambia. Their yield is probably 0.3% or even less than that. So, now what did Vajpayee government do? They denationalized Hindustan Zinc and did it in such a fraudulent manner. You cannot imagine the kind of fraudulent manner in which they did it. The entire mines, Zawari mines, Rajpur mines, Dabri mines, were all declared as not having anything, even though they had 113 million tons and non-operational. And suddenly they started operating, and one of these secretaries of Rajasthan government is in jail. And there was such a race between Chidambaram and Jaitley to sell whatever balance of equity, that's 29% that was left, to be sold urgently so that Vedanta gets 100% control. I moved the Supreme Court, NCO moved the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court has stayed it. Our argument was that if it is such a strategic mineral, you have only a tiny foothold by having 26%, why are you in such a rush to sell off this when there is a CBI inquiry into this whole thing? Anyway, Supreme Court stalled it. Then you have, you know, the need to break monopolies. Instead of breaking monopolies, we have privatized to create monopolies. IPCL. Today there is only one single person in this country making petrochemicals, which is Reliance. There was absolutely no reason why you should have sold IPCL to Reliance. You could have sold it to somebody else. But you just sold it to consolidate the... which is against your directive principles of the Constitution. Challenging international cartel. All your oil companies, they were what? They were to address the challenge to international cartels. India did not even know how to purchase oil, forget about anything else. If you read the Damle Committee report, if you see read the other report, we didn't even know how to then purchase oil, forget about it. And it's not that, you know, the nationalization of the oil companies was done in a manner that was unacceptable to America or to the Western countries or to the Burma Shell and the Stanback and the Caltex. It was not a nationalization as was done in Cuba or somewhere else. It was a nationalization where we gave them for each and every brick and stone. We compensated them for every screwdriver, every nail, every bolt we paid for. Why did they agree to get themselves nationalized? Because we had built a parallel Indian oil. And the parallel Indian oil was now in marketing and giving them a challenge. And they had old refineries. So they thought it is much wiser to not invest in this old refineries and invest in marketing. It's much wiser to control the selling part of oil. Because these fools don't know how to buy the oil, we'll make more money there. So they allowed this to happen. That's how then the whole question of being pioneers in industry. I don't have to go into that. No, you know, then there is always constantly about privatization, private. But where is the private sector? There is no such thing called private sector. There are only two sectors, public owned, private managed. Public owned, public managed sector. None of these fellows have any of their money, it's your money and my money which is sitting there, with which they are doing, which is called private sector. The word private sector is a wrong usage of word. You should say public owned, private, or public financed, private managed. Public finance, public managed. Now, a lot is made out of, you know, loss-making units being inefficient. Now, let me quickly run through these loss-making units being inefficient. When you sell something below cost, like electricity, you are bound to make loss. When you have inadequate orders, like Hindustan Steel Construction Corporation, was set up, which was a contractor company for building steel plants, but you didn't build steel plants. So it was sure to go into a loss. Then lack of timely modernization. This is the problem which all these companies like Hindustan Organics are facing. They have a mother unit in Rasayani, they have a unit in Cochin. Now, because politicians wanted a modernization unit to be set somewhere else in their constituency, instead of modernizing Rasayani, a Cochin unit was set up. So you have the modern technology in Cochin and you have outdated dead technology and the old unit in Rasayani. The Rasayani makes loss, the Cochin makes profit, together they make loss. No, this is, I mean, very roughly the kind of situation in the public sector. Now let me come to this question of relationship between the banks and the public sector. Now what actually takes place? What actually takes place is that you open up the entire market. You say defense is opened, power sector is opened, this thing is opened, that thing is opened, this, everything is open, but there's no money. I run off to build a powerhouse, but there is no money. So what do? You borrow. And where do you borrow it from? You borrow it from the banks. And then, so what has happened is that banks had money, but they had no expertise in dealing with infrastructure industries, because there were a separate set of institutions which were created for that purpose, IFCI, IDBI, etc. So what you do is you tell IDBI you go into banking and you tell banks to go into infrastructure lending. So the IDBI is told to set up a bank, IDBI bank, when that is not their job. And the bank is told to go and set up go and lend to a powerhouse, which is not their job. They never knew how to sell to if you look at the figures, the bank loans to infrastructure has gone up by 100 times in the last 15 years. 100 times in the last 15 years, the bank loans to infrastructure. In 2000, the loans that were given out were 7,243 crores on infrastructure, which is about 3.62%. And in 2013, it was 7,86,045 crores, which is about 35.25%. So from 7,000 crores, you have gone to 7 lakh crores of lending to infrastructure. And almost simultaneously, 30 banks have an NPA which has risen to about 95%, by about 95%. So you can see the relationship between this kind of lending, the NPAs, and now, if you look at these fellows, when you say, I have set up a power plant, when you look at them, you see that the profits and resources have not been a means of independent investment in the projects. The share of profits and reserves as a part of project cost has gone from 0.63 to 10.5, the maximum 10.5. That means from their own reserves, from Reliance reserves or reserves and profits, share is very less. All of it is from borrowing. Now what happens? I set up a power plant. The power industry makes a loss, or I make a loss, or I likely to make a loss. Let me also very quickly tell you what is happening even in the power sector very quickly. I don't know, I'm under so much tension of time, but this is a very important link, so I'll finish this link. You know, there was a mega power plants. They said 4,000 megawatts and all in private sector will have public-private partnership and all that. Then what happened? The Tatas were given Mundra. They set up a power plant. After setting up a power plant, then they go and ask for an increase in tariff. When the basis of getting a tender is the tariff. Same thing was done with telecom. This ability to get the terms of contract changed after the contract. When Kejriwal talks of corruption, he talks of transaction costs, not corruption. You know, did a policeman take 10 rupees, 5 rupees? Those are transaction costs. Corruption is here. When you change the contract terms after the ending of contract, these are not issues which all these crusaders like Anna Hazare are raising. So what happens? The Tatas bid and get a powerhouse at 2.6 rupees per unit. Then they go to the CERC and get an increase of 52 paisa. Then the electricity boards go to the Supreme Court and get a stay. So the Reliance is even better than Tata. At least Tata's finish the project and then go for it. At least they invest in them. Reliance sat and waited. And the minute the Supreme Court put a stay, they said, we don't want to do this project anymore. We abandon it. So they abandon it. You know, in Tamil Nadu in 2013, there were huge power cuts. Huge power cuts. And Jayalalitha abused the public sector undertaking. What were the reason for those power cuts? It was just we were unable to transfer power from one end of the country to another. Why? Because, for example, the Talcher Srikota line, there were two lines. One was given to IPCL and another was given to private sector. IP, PGIL, Power Grid Corporation. Power Grid completed its line, the second film has never completed their line. And so the power could not be transferred. Same the Reliance did. They were supposed to finish their transmission line by 2012. In 2013 they said, no, we are going to abandon it. You can abandon a project without being penalized. Without being penalized. So what happened? There was no ability to transfer the power. This was entirely due to a failure of the private sector fellows. Not because of PGI. But these facts are not brought out. Jay Lalitha abuses the public sector because it's very easy to abuse. No. So you can put a fellow in jail even though the police says he didn't raise a slogan. So even if I'm not guilty, I can be made guilty. It's a very strange situation. Now what happens is that you don't have money, you get into a power project, and mind you, this import of coal, the loss, the fraud is to the extent of 30,000 crores. Serious fraud investigation office is looking into it, but nobody has been held responsible. Nobody has gone to jail. ONG, Reliance has been caught red-handed stealing ONGC gas, and this has been established by an independent UK company, but nobody has gone to jail. Enron came, Enron went, left a loss of 25,000 crores. Nobody went to jail. So private sector can loot to whatever they want, but nobody will go to jail. That immunity is given to them. But no, what happens? I get into a power project. The power project gets into a loss. No, I don't have money because, as I said, only 10% of the money I have invested, 90% I borrowed from you. No, because I got into a loss, you create an NPA. Because you create an NPA, you have to be recapitalized. Because you have to be recapitalized, government says it's better to allow it to open it to public, so we privatize it. So the NPA, you know, it's a very convenient cycle. I borrow money, I create a default. The default requires recapitalization. Government says, no, go back to this fellow who stole in the first place. So the crook who stole me, is, then it becomes the cause for taking it over. What a convenient way. First I steal your money and then I become your owner. Wonderful, you know, this whole circle, you go full circle and you come and capture this. So it's not just, you see, it's this kind of a circular logic that is going on, which needs to be looked at. Finally, I would like to say only one thing, that I think that it is time that all of us look at these issues politically. Politically, the country is ready in a very, very serious situation. Your entire agriculture sector, all the five pillars on which it was standing, they are being demolished one after another. It's just a matter of time that agriculture is going to collapse. And when agriculture collapses, this nation is going to collapse. They were sitting on priority lending. He has just explained how it has all been demolished. They were sitting on cheap electricity. Now we are talking cheap electricity, mind you. They say populism, populism, populism. There is no populism. I am growing rice. Parveen Jha is growing rice. He gets canal irrigated water. I have to dig a tube well and pay for electricity. How can we both sell the rice in the same market? Until and unless, all that the farmer is saying, make the two equal. If you make the two equal, electricity has to be given free. There is no populism in that. So, seeds was in public sector. Now it's care of Monsanto. Diesel was in public sector. Now they are going to, administered prices are going to be removed. It's going to be liberalized. So when you take away credit, when you take away seeds, when you take away electricity, when you take away diesel, when you take away fertilizer, when you take away all these five, there is no way that agriculture is going to survive. What it will result is, if you and I do not manage it properly, I am very lucky, I am the luckiest amongst all of you because I am 70 and I will not live very long. But you are going to live
మచ్ యంగర్ దెన్ మీ.
ఈ వీడియో మీకు నచ్చినట్లయితే లైక్ చేయండి, మీకు తెలిసిన వారితో షేర్ చేయండి. ఇలాంటి వీడియోస్ మరిన్ని చూడటానికి మన ఛానల్కి సబ్స్క్రైబ్ చేసుకోండి. పక్కనే ఉన్న బెల్ ఐకాన్ క్లిక్ చేసి ఆల్ నోటిఫికేషన్స్ సెలెక్ట్ చేసుకోండి.